Now let us see in this part 3 the clinical manifestations of the stroke patients and the neurological deficit which it can lead to depending on the location of the lesion, which vessel is obstructed, the size of the area of the inadequate perfusion or amount of the collateral blood circulation. Not necessarily all the stroke patient will manifest in the similar fashion, so they may manifest into a different ways. So it's a disease of opomotor neuron lesions and results in loss of voluntary control over the motor movements. Opomotor neuron, as you know, decussate, most common motor dysfunction is hemiplegia due to lesion of the opposite side of the brain. Hemiparesis is also another sign, that means it's a weakness. Hemiplegia is the total loss of the function of that particular limb. Evidence of an upper motor neuron lesions may be that there is a drift of the upper limb, that means they lift, the limbs are in a particular fashion, like flexors are hyperfunctioning compared to the extensors. Weakness with a characteristic distribution, increase in the tone of spastic type, exaggerated tendon reflexes, an extensor plantar response, the loss of fine finger toe movements, loss of abdominal reflexes, which is one of the superficial reflexes. There is no muscular wasting per se into the upper motor neuron lesions, but in the long term, because of the disuse atrophy, you may find sometimes that there is a wasting of the muscles, right? And there may normal electrical excitability of the muscles, which is not seen in the lower motor neuron lesions. Characteristics of the upper motor neuron lesion, further we see that normally the outstretched upper limbs are held symmetrically with the pyramidal lesions. Both the upper limbs are held outstretched, palms uppermost, and the affected limb drifts toward downwards and medially. The forearm trends to pronate and finger flex slightly. This is often the first sign. The weakness and loss of skill movement, unilateral pyramidal tract lesions, above the decussation, that is in the medulla oblongata or internal capsule, causes the contralateral hemiplegia. In slowly progressive lesions, that is the like example cortical gliomas, a characteristic pattern of increasing weakness emerges in the hemiparetic limb, and it will be a slow progressive lesions. In the upper limb, flexors remain stronger than the extensors, while in the lower limb, extensors remain stronger than the flexors. In the upper arms, the weakness movements are thus shoulder abduction, elbow extension in the forearm and hand, wrist and finger extensors and abductors are weaker than the antagonistic muscles. The reflexes in the upper motor neuron lesions, normally there will be a positive Babinski sign, that is upgoing reflex. And in severe lesions, that is internal capsule infarct, this extensor response can be elicited from a wide area of the affected limb. As the recovery progresses, the area that is receptive diminishes only until the posterior third of the lateral aspect of the sole. An extensor plantar is certain when dorsiflexion of the great toe is accompanied by fanning of the adjacent toe. Abdominals, that is our cremastic reflexes, are abolished on the affected site. The clinical pattern of the upper motor neuron lesions may be into hemiparesis, that is weakness of one side, parasis, which is not commonly seen, a weakness of both the lower limbs, or in spinal cord lesions. Motor cortex confined to one contralateral limb, that is monoplegia, a defect in the higher cortical functions, aphasia and a focal epilepsy may occur, that is into the cerebral cortex lesions. Whenever the internal capsule is involved, the corticospinal tracts since become dense, therefore there may be a bigger deficit. A large deficit will lead to a contralateral hemiplegia, and there will be a dense hemiplegia, and particularly whenever there is a middle cerebral artery involved. In lesions of the pons, you will find that confined to corticospinal tract, adjacent structures such as 6 or 7 nuclei, internuclear ophthalmoplegia, or lateral gaze palsy with the contralateral hemiparesis. These may be the features of the pontine lesions. In the spinal cord regions, epsilateral upper motor neuron lesions, the level indicated by changes in the reflexes like negative biceps or triceps like that. In contrast to the upper motor neuron lesions, the lower motor neuron lesions is the motor pathway from the anterior horn cells via the peripheral nerve or the motor end plates. The motor unit consists of a single anterior horn cell, single fast conducting motor nerve fibers that leaves the spinal cord via the anterior root. The group of muscles or fibers being supplied via the mixed peripheral nerves. The anterior horn cell activity is modulated by impulses from corticospinal tracts, extrapyramidal system, cerebellum, efferent fibers from the posterior roots. If you look at the signs of the lower motor neuron lesions, there could be weakness, wasting, hypotonia, loss of reflexes, fasciculations, contractures of the muscles in the long term, or there could be trophic changes into the skin and the nails. That is a long term effect. If you look at the causes of lower motor neuron lesions, cranial nerve nuclei or anterior horn cells present like a Bell's phenomena, motor neuron disease, poliomyelitis, spinal roots may be affected leading to a cervical or lumbar disc protrusions, neuralgic amyotrophy, peripheral or cranial nerve traumas, entrapment, mononeuritis multiplex, all these can lead to a lower motor neuron lesions. If you look at the speech disorders which may be accompanying with hemiplegia, which commonly you can come across, is aphasia or dysphasia. It may be transient or for more longer duration. There could be a receptive aphasia, sounds or speech, nor its meaning can be understood as a spoken speech or the written speech. There is also another entity called expressive aphasia, difficulty in speaking and writing. In the clinical examination, you can always try to ask the patient to write down and you can see that whether there is a defect and also the listening component. Dysarthria affects the mechanics of the speech due to the muscles, control disturbances, pronunciations, phonation, lot of things you need to check when you are doing a clinical examination for the speech disorders. Another thing which you have to look into is visual perception dysfunctions due to disturbance of the primary sensory pathways between the eye and the visual cortex. There could be homonymous hemianopia, loss of the half of the visual field, may be temporary or permanent. The affected side of the vision corresponds to the paralyzed size of the body. Patient's head turns away from the affected side of the lesions in the body. The disturbance of the visual spatial relationship, perceiving the relationship of two or more objects in the spatial areas. You have to see the discrimination, 2-point discrimination. Frequently seen in patients with left-sided hemiplegia. Patient may not be able to dress him or herself by his or his ability to match his clothing to his body parts. Accompanying this, there could be sensory losses, loss of proprioceptions, inability to perceive position or motion of the body parts, difficulty interpreting visual, tactile, auditory stimuli. So all these, when doing a clinical examination, you need to check for all these relationships. If you look at this picture, which give you a, by and large, a rough idea that whenever there is a right-sided brain damage, it will represent as left-sided hemiplegia. I am talking in a broader term. It may not be essential in individual cases, but most of the time, if there is a right-sided brain damage, there will be a left-sided hemiplegia, or if there is a left-sided brain damage, it could be a right-sided hemiplegia. And the speech disturbances are more common when the lesion is on the left side. You see at this particular picture, there is a brain damage on the left brain and the right-sided body is getting weak. And these patients may present with paralyzed right side, impaired speech or language, slow performance, visual field defects, awareness of the deficit, depression, anxiety, impaired comprehension, even small things like higher functions losses could be there along with this type of hemiplegias. On the other hand, if you see the other picture where there is a right-sided stroke, right, and the brain damage is on the right brain damage and left side body weakness. The paralyzed side, left side hemiplegia, special perceptual deficit tend to minimize the problem, short attention span, visual field effects, impaired judgment, impulsive or impaired time conception, right? They are not aware of where they are, right? That is one of the important things in the right-sided stroke. If you look at the overall, that the stroke may present to you in a different manner. So these are the clinical features which you should keep in mind when looking for a patient with stroke. Headache is one of the important areas which differentiate intracerebral leak with the ischemic stroke. The mental changes, confusion, disorientation, memory impairment, aphasia, respiratory problem, decrease in the neuromuscular control, cough or swallowing reflex, agnesia or incontinence, and there may be seizures. All these could be a presenting features of a stroke. Whereas there may be emotional abilities, visual disturbances. Horner syndrome is another one which you have to keep in mind, where could be ptosis of the upper lid with the unequal pupils, perceptual defects, hypertension and apraxias. There could be a focal neurological lesions, or there could be a generalized lesions. There could be confusion, vertigo, dysarthria, transient hemiparesis, temporary vision changes, last a few minutes to 24 hours. So you have to understand that the patients with clinical stroke may present to you in a different manner, and all those could be affecting the lesions, the type of lesions, the extent of the damage, and also you have to make a clinical diagnosis depending on the site of lesions.